The January 6th committee has just subpoenaed the former president, Donald Trump. Back with CNN's Evan Perez, CNN senior legal analyst Ellie Honig, CNN's chief political analyst Gloria Borger. Ellie, we've been reading through the letter accompanying the subpoena, and I want to read the last sentence here of page 4 here. And they write, "The select committee looks forward to your cooperation with the subpoena." I'm sure whomever typed that smirked as they were keying through it. What are the options next for the former president? As he now reads through the request.
Yeah, I think that's an optimistic statement there, Victor. So Donald Trump really has three options here. One, he can comply. He can turn over all the requested documents by November 4th. He can show up to testify on November 14th. But important to note, what the committee is saying here is you are commanded to show up for a deposition behind closed doors, which will be done by our staff and our members, and they do make a point of noting several of whom are former federal prosecutors. Wink, wink. Now, that's option one. Unlikely Donald Trump fully complies. Option two is Donald Trump's team can try to negotiate with the committee and say, well, he'll testify about these topics, but not these other topics. He'll give you some documents. In the real world, that happens quite frequently. We'll see if they're able to find some agreement here. And option number three for Donald Trump is just outright defiance. I refuse. No way. Make me.
You know, one thing else that stood out to me when we're talking about what the legal response could be, and we were talking before the break about how much information is actually in this letter here. There's a note specifically, we were talking about privilege before the break, but it specifically talks about the validity of the asserted privilege, saying we recognize the Supreme Court has ruled former presidents retain the limited ability to assert executive privilege, going on to say that's qualified, noting the D.C. Circuit explained specifically in the case of Trump v. Thompson that if there's a uniquely compelling need, you might have to give up the information, Ellie.
Yeah, so this is what's known as a flex. Basically, the committee is reminding Donald Trump, hey, you tried to invoke executive privilege before in a dispute over documents, White House documents with the archives, and you lost in the courts. The D.C. Circuit, as you just said, Erica, shot that down. The Supreme Court refused to take up the case. And basically, they said, as a former president, you have a very limited, if any, interest in invoking executive privilege. And so the committee's reminding Donald Trump, if you want to try to invoke executive privilege here, go ahead. You have to let us know soon. And we intend to take it to courts. And by the way, we had this fight once before, and we won, and the courts rejected your executive privilege claim.
And look at what Judge Carter said yesterday. I mean, Judge Carter went even further and said, you know, there's no privilege in these four documents if it looks like a crime might have been committed. The committee did not use that as an example because I think they didn't want to push that far. But that has certainly been the record of Judge Carter in the case of the Mar-a-Lago documents.
I was going to come to you on, you know, this long list of information they want from Signal, from any of these electronic devices.
Yeah.
And what the committee has shown us over the last several months is that they have so much more than is public, than we're seeing and hearing in these hearings. They might have so much of this already from some other interview, some other source.
Yeah, and this goes back to the point that Evan was making, which is they have a lot of these communications, and what they're probably doing in a lot of these things is triage, because they may know what was in these conversations. And we've reported, you know, months ago, that it was also Donald Trump's habit very often to turn to an aide and say, give me your phone, or call so-and-so, and use that person's phone and to have the phone conversation, whether those conversations were on Signal, not on Signal, you know, whether they were just over the transom, we don't know. So my guess is, as Evan was saying, is that they do know what a lot of these conversations were. They do know what was being said, but not from the president himself. You know, he often went out of his way to avoid the White House switchboard, as we know from January 6th.
Yeah. And that may be another flex, right? Saying, hey, we know these communications happened.
Right.
We would like to see more of them. Evan,
exactly.
In this letter, the committee mentioned some legislative recommendations. Interesting that those were put in there.
Yeah, look, I think that's a pre-buttal because we've seen this argument in some of the litigation by Steve Bannon and some of the other people who've been subpoenaed by this committee. And one of the things that they've argued, including by the former president himself, in that litigation over those records that the committee got from the National Archives, one of the things they point out that they've argued is that, you know, this committee is a political committee. There are, you know, not any Republicans that were approved by the leadership of the Republicans in the House, and so therefore there is no legitimate legislative purpose for this committee. And obviously they've lost that argument a couple of times, but here the committee goes ahead and points it out once more, just in case this goes before a different judge. And then they say, as is likely obvious from the topics identified, we are considering multiple legislative recommendations intended to provide further assurance that no future president could succeed at anything even remotely similar to the unlawful steps you took. This is them prebutting what they expect the former president and his legal team to go big on, which is that this is a political committee that has no real purpose.
Well, we'll be watching for that response. Ellie Honig, Gloria Borger, Evan Perez, appreciate it. Thank you all. Thank you.
All right, some of the documents the FBI recovered from Donald Trump's Mar-a-Lago estate include highly sensitive intelligence regarding China and Iran. That's according to new reporting from the Washington Post.
Sources tell the paper at least one document has information about Iran's missile program. Devlin Barrett broke the story, joins us now. So, Devlin, do you have a sense from your sources of just how detailed that information is?
Well, it's described as pretty detailed to us, and, you know, these are among the most worrisome things that the FBI has found in the course of its investigation, just because the potential harm of it falling into the wrong hands would be so great.
Yeah. The Post reported some time back that some of the documents included information about foreign nuclear capabilities. Is there any clarity as if these were the Iranian-related documents, if those are the same?
That part we still don't know. We don't know if that is also a description. That description also applies to the Iranian document or the China documents or something else. There's still a lot to figure out here. But I think what's important about this section is it speaks to the severity of potential harm that might have happened if this information had gotten out into the wild.
And it also, right, brings up the concern that there could still be documents that we heard about. There could still be documents there. It's not just Iran. Your reporting says other documents described highly sensitive intelligence work aimed at China as well.
Right. And so some of these documents, we're told, describe intelligence gathering activities targeting China. And obviously China is one of the major U.S. adversaries in the world, and that relationship is very tense, particularly on the intelligence front. And if you call back a couple of years, you'll remember that our country recently lost a lot of intelligence assets in the China space. And so obviously anything that could cause further damage to our intelligence gathering capability over there is very concerning.
And of course, we remember that there was a Chinese national who was arrested there, who was on the property at Mar-a-Lago, the president's resort. Did your source give you any details about what would be jeopardized if these were to fall into the wrong hands, if those sources and methods would be jeopardized?
Well, again, what would be at risk would be sensitive intelligence work at China. And obviously if that were exposed, those sources and methods would almost certainly be compromised, and to the degree that, you know, there could be potential danger to individuals. And so that's important. One other thing that our reporting shows is that a lot of these documents were top-level analysis documents, so there has been a lot of concern over human sources being identified in these documents. We're told that there aren't even in the most sensitive documents, there aren't many names of individuals. So that is less of a concern, but there is still very, very sensitive information in these documents.
All right, Devlin.